thank you for joining. I'm excited to share with you my experiences of the knowledge management project. We've all been in the situation where we're looking for a document or a dashboard, and you might find nothing at all, or you might find way more than you wanted. You get a lot of results, but it's not really clear if they're meaningful or not. And at Netflix, we face this challenge quite a bit. There are a lot of reasons this happens. A doc might be out of date. It might be deprecated. It might be one of multiple versions of the same doc. There might be unknown differences between similar docs. So today, what we want to talk about is some of the lessons that I learned from looking at search solutions and how that influenced our design. And then we'll look at how we make decisions about which sources of information to include. And then finally, about the data engineering challenges of capturing contextual information about our resources. And we're going to wrap up with helping people gain insights using all of the tools from that. So getting started with search. Google search is the gold standard of user experience because it's just a simple text box. It doesn't get any easier than that. This obviously doesn't help us very much with internal resources. You can't Google search across the documents that people shared for you, but it's a good place to start thinking. Another problem, you get 55 million results when you do a not super specific search, but a search about a topic. And I definitely don't need that many. So Google Drive, we now have our internal docs, but we still have very little contextual information about the results that we got. We just see that there's a document, we see who shared it, we see when it was shared, whether it was owned by me or owned by someone else, but not any of the useful information about what's inside that document, aside from the search string that we use to search for it. None of the data that's in our business systems is tied to the search results that we get to help us search or to narrow the results. So it's still easy to use, but it results the results lack the context. Next up, we have cloud search. Cloud search is kind of Google Drive search, but on steroids, right? It's the next step. But there's no information about why or how a document was shared. The information about the intended audience is gone. I can search Google Groups. I can find particular information. I can find any of these little subsections, but I can't limit my search to documents that were published by people within a particular org. I don't have any of the contextual information about those people, only who they are as individuals. So now this tool has about the maximum number of features that we want in a user experience. They've taken the Google search and added more and more and more filters, something that's broadly applicable to different organizations. But now that we have this kind of maximum number of user experience features, we're kind of at a dead end to what we can get. But going back to the Google search for inspiration, what were some of the keys that make that really successful as a search? So the best thing that they do, they prevent noise. Okay, I told people before this presentation, I took out all the cute slides. So I took out some cats, but I left the birds. I like the birds. Google search, it prevents noise, and they do that by ranking by likelihood. As you're typing, you get to see what some of the potential matches are. And they're ranked by how likely it is, how popular that item is. Another thing is when you actually perform the search, you see some of the context about the things that came back. You're not just seeing a huge list of links. You're seeing some information up front that might help you understand how that particular topic is thought about. So armed with all this knowledge, we started making our own portal. And this is the solution we came up with. It's called Insights Finder. We only include a curated set of sources, including documents and popular internal dashboards and web applications. We follow links for a few hops, but we use a relevancy score to reduce noise, and I'll touch on this in a little bit. And we attempt to remove resources that are deprecated or still in draft. We built this with a team of three people. There's a PM, a front-end developer, and a back-end developer, which is me. And there were also a host of designers and visualization specialists and researchers on the Consumer Insights team who helped us immensely, to which I'm eternally grateful. I'll speak mostly about the data and the decisions we made in that back-end data area. But the data needs were ultimately driven by the needs of the front-end features that we were trying to enable, and also by they were guided by the stakeholders that we had, the researchers. So one of the things that we tried to replicate was ranking by likelihood. Our search uses the information we have about internal entities to rank the likelihood that you're searching for them, such as the popularity of a show or the size of a particular market. We also have contextual information that we get from other systems to help people find the resources they're most likely to be up to date. So we don't want to just include documents that may be years old. We want to show people the latest and greatest numbers from dashboards. And I'd like to show you how we arrived at this solution. And the first thing was considering our sources. So we evaluated a lot of sources of information, beginning with those that we thought would have the greatest impact. We included databases, Google Drives, Airtables, curated research portals, APIs that returned links or data, spreadsheets that were full of links, and also including links within the documents that we found from those other sources. And we needed to determine which ones of these sources and the resources that they provided would be a priority. We also wanted to ensure that the curation that all of these people across the business had done on their own sources wasn't going to be diluted by including them. In our initial discovery phase, one of the first things that I did was to start following the links. How many documents are in this universe? What are we actually looking at? And that's where things got a little bit overwhelming. The number of documents kept growing, and it wasn't that the number kept going up linearly. We were seeing exponential growth in the number of documents. At first, I had the hypothesis that this was going to, at some point, level out. We were going to hit the universe of Netflix documents, and then it was going to start to reduce. But instead, what we were seeing was the number and the rate at which it was growing kept climbing. It turned out there were several reasons that this was going on. One of them is particularly interesting. It was easy to solve, but what was happening in the early times of the pandemic, some people across the company shared out helpful links about school resources. And a lot of those school resources were shared documents that were shared across school districts, and they were linked to other resources. And those were linked to other schools. And what was happening was that my process was scraping, it had gotten free of Netflix, and I was basically scraping the internet at this point. So it was easy enough to apply rules about type of documents and to look for particular types of topics. But what we were finding is the more we applied these rules, that one was the biggest one for sure. But the more we considered this, the more we realized that we needed a different mindset. Instead of looking at as many resources as we possibly could, we started wondering about really focusing on prioritizing our sources. So how do we know which sources to consider? The key to all this was focus. By focusing on select sources as good places to go for ground truth, we can create distinct themes about the resources, such as when I say resource, I mean a document or a dashboard or a presentation or a spreadsheet. Those are all resources. Or a table that you might get from a query, things like that. So each of these are thematically linked to one or more of these sources that we're finding. And every resource is given a relevancy score. And the relevancy score has to do with how far away it is from one of these trusted sources. So we might have a source that has a really high trust score, and the further away, the more links you are from that source, the less you get to inherit some of its trustworthiness. It's very similar to PageRank. It's kind of like an opinionated version of PageRank, where we're deciding ahead of time that we believe in certain things. So in our case at Netflix, we're really interested in research from our consumer insights team. That was our initial project, was to create a portal for them. These resources are fundamentally different from the resources that come from strictly the product team or from the content team, but we wanted to share those sources of information as well. It's really important to know about the connections between these things. So we wanted to explore how to get context, and we wanted to put all of these sources of information together. One of the big challenges, though, if the research that we're exposing, if it's valuable to a large group of people, they want to understand content, they want to understand our audience over time, they want to understand experiments that we've done on our product. But what happens is a lot of people make these search portals, and then someone else will make a search portal that incorporates the other search portals. And I think that this is still an unsolved problem. This is still going to continue to happen. And by choosing to narrow our domain to product, content, consumer insights type of research, and not including things like human resources types of resources, and human resources squared for the engineers here, or engineering documents, which is more near and dear to our hearts. Those types of information are fundamentally different from research. One of the things that you want when you're looking at what experiments have we done in the past in product, or what content has proven successful in different markets, you want to look back historically and find out what people have tried before. You want to see the themes that have emerged and the history. But when you're looking for what is an HR policy, how does my insurance work, or what is the API for this particular library, you want the current doc only. You really don't care about how historically that topic has evolved. You only want a particular thing. So we chose to focus on the previous type of information, the research type of information, and how those themes have changed over time. And it may be that this is going to lead us to become yet another portal in this series of portals. But the important thing is that we take the information that we've gotten and we bring it together with context from all of our systems. So how do we capture that context? And there are some themes within this section. One of them is partnering with stakeholders. One of them is leveraging information about entities that we get from our systems and we find that are in these documents. And then one of them is finding sources of metadata about those entities. So I'll speak to each of these in turn. I want to tell you about one of the things that I tried first, which was to create a model of our overall business. Like, what is our business? What are all the different things that make up our business? So topic modeling. This is probably my driest slide, especially after the one with the huge wave, right? This is just me being absolutely dry. I looked at LDA, latent Dirichlet allocation, which is really just a way of saying there are a bunch of different topics that make up every document. And this model starts with kind of a random combination, but it sorts out what is the distribution of topics in this particular document. And by doing that, you can eventually find clusters of your documents. And by looking at those clusters, you can eventually say, this one is about localization, for example, or this one is about some other topic, right? So by doing that, the hope was that I could discover what all the topics are and all of the documents across Netflix. So I used a library called Tomatopy. I've never heard that said out loud. I've never, except for practicing this presentation, I've never said that out loud. So I don't know if it's Tomotopy, Tomatopy, Tomotopy, because it's Python, maybe, I don't know. But the reason that I chose this particular one, it's really one of those libraries that implements a lot of ideas from different papers. And although this is a large number of documents, the performance of this particular type of analysis isn't something that's very challenging. So it's fine to just use a somewhat academic library. But the main reason I used it is for this function, set word prior. And the idea of this function is that you can choose a topic, you can choose a word, and you can say the likelihood of this word showing up in cluster one, for example, is high or is low. So the advantage of doing this is that you could pick a bunch of words and you could say, I want a topic that's going to be about globalization, for example, or about translation, subtitles, subs, dubs, all of the different things that you want to be in that topic. And you can kind of choose beforehand what you want that topic to contain. So what's the advantage of doing this? Well, Tomatopi, whatever, it gives you the ability to find these clusters automatically, but a lot of the clusters that it finds are going to be full of kind of junk. So the more topics that you can define where you have a good understanding of what's in those clusters, the more you can start to reduce the number of those unknown clusters. So I went through this process of finding topics automatically and then using set word prior to kind of nail those topics in place and add other related keywords to try to influence how the clusters were built. And this manual curation process, I ended up with 40 some groups, topics, which contained over 1200 keywords that I just sourced from talking to people and finding them in documents and things like that. And let it discover the rest. So the idea was to use business context up to a point and then to use machine learning to discover the things which weren't discovered yet, and then to iterate from there. And TSNI, or the T-distributed stochastic neighbor embedding, I think, is just a, I only know about using it for display, right? If you have some sort of n-dimensional vector in space and you want to show it in a way, you want to show all of your points on a scatter plot in two dimensions or in three dimensions, TSNI is just one of these like dimensional reduction techniques where you end up with a pretty good representation and your points aren't all overlapping, but the clusters make sense, right? So it's a just a library. But looking at these clusters was very interesting. And some of the visualization people who I work with kind of took it and ran with it. And we have these beautiful looking clusters of what Netflix business looks like. So success? Not at all. That was ultimately all of that dry stuff on that slide. I don't want to say that it was a waste of time. I'm very glad that I did it. But it is not the way that we found we should model the business of Netflix. These documents that were created in the past. They're a snapshot of things that happened in time, and they're not a high fidelity snapshot. Those are only the docs that we captured. Ultimately, that's a backwards approach. We want to look at the current state of the business and people's plans going forward. We want to incorporate the past, but we want that to be structured in such a way that makes sense to people, not according to this kind of machine learned approach that is somehow kind of academically pure. So the important thing here was to partner with our business stakeholders to design the system to reflect why people want those resources, including resources that don't exist yet. So we partnered with a librarian to build a business taxonomy that makes sense and is expandable. We also leaned away from thinking about scoring every document against every topic, which was kind of how we assumed things would be at the beginning. We would have a huge matrix of documents versus topics, and every single document would have a score against every single topic. And now we're just depending on search. We not every document is discoverable by navigating through our taxonomy, and that's just how it should be. Only the ones that have been pinned there by business experts who deem those documents to be important. And we try to use things like machine learning to surface documents to those people so that they have ideas, but ultimately we're relying on their judgment about whether that document still represents that topic enough to be shared. So what about other types of contextual information? The next step is, how do we use all the context that's built into our other systems? And this is entity resolution. What we want to do is consider that an object that is represented by some text is that object. It is not that text. If I know that a doc mentions me or it's written by me, I want to be able to search by my email address or by my name. If I had a nickname, not inviting one, but if I had one, I would want people to be able to locate my documents by using that. I would want them to be able to search for me in all of those different ways, and then locate documents that referred to me in any of those ways. There are a lot of different ways that you can approach entity resolution. There's a more heuristic approach. Heuristic just meaning that you can manually curate your search strings, and you can use information from a lot of different automated sources. Like, for example, we have the names of all of our movie titles in a lot of different languages, and we have the alternate titles that are used. So we could use that in the heuristic approach. There are also machine learning approaches where you can use models of grammar to kind of determine that when they said stranger things, they were talking about a thing, not about two words, things that happen to be strange, right? So ultimately, I decided to go with the heuristic approach. And I feel that it's best to start that way and then maybe to use that information to feed a machine learning approach. But we don't require that things be grammatically correct in order to discover that they're entities. What we leave on the table by doing this is if someone says the performance of Stranger Things was great, it was very successful. We're not capturing the it as a referent to Stranger Things in this case. All we're doing is knowing that this document mentioned Stranger Things once. So this is something that could continue to be improved in our entity resolution model. All right, so what are some of the challenges we faced? One of them is that there are complicated matching rules, right? It's not enough to say anytime you mention United States that you're talking about United States. It might be that you're talking about the United States minor outlying islands. And in that case, we would have missed the rest of that string if we only matched on the substring. Likewise, Beyond Stranger Things is a title that has Stranger Things right in that title. And we have to know that if Beyond comes before it, we're probably talking about that other thing. And there are some other challenges here too. Scale is an issue. And words that are really common, right? Words that, let's see, my presentation is not working. Right. Words that come up all the time. We want to have flexibility. For some reason, I'm not able to forward. There we go. I have to go back to the speaker's notes here. All right. So we want to be able to tackle this, but in a way that gives us flexibility to not only develop solutions, but also to evolve them to handle new cases. All right. So one way that we could approach this is using Netflix titles as an example. What if we took every word, associated it with an ID, and then we wrote some Spark code, for example, to search for all of those words and then to emit those IDs when we found them? But how will we do that? One of the ways that we could do that would be to explode the list and to take advantage of parallelism, right? This works, but it has some drawbacks. One of the big drawbacks, well, a drawback, is that there's a huge number of jobs that are created, because we have hundreds of thousands of documents, and we have around 100,000 show title names, for example. So we end up with a lot of very small jobs in that case. That's not the worst thing in the world. We can take advantage of parallelism, but it's also not the most efficient approach. A bigger problem with this is that searches are all independent of each other. So if one search matches, we can't use that information to influence whether we think something else is a match. It may be that we want to put in logic that says, if we match on Stranger Things, for example, then if we locate ST, the two letters ST, as a standalone thing, we're probably talking about Stranger Things in that document as well. Whereas we might not be quite as sure in other situations. Maybe a better example for that one would be if we have a doc that's about India, the country ISO code for India is IN. If we see the capital letters IN in a document, we're not going to guess automatically in just any document that that's what we're referring to necessarily. But if we found that the document is about India, then there's a much higher probability that that's what that is referring to. Okay, so another approach would be to broadcast the list. In this case, we have one job per document, right? Because we have the entire list and we have a function that's going to go through that broadcasted list and search for everything. And this has the advantage that searches are no longer independent. You could use a match of one thing to influence the likelihood of a match of another thing. So this is successful, but it's a lot of information to broadcast. Especially if we want to do things like look at all of our talent names together with all of our show titles, right? We want to say, we want to have conditional logic for things like that. So one of the approaches that I tried here that ended up working was a tri data structure. This executes all of your searches at once. So the way that this works is you start going through a document word by word, and you look in your try data structure to see if that prefix, that first word, for example, is in the try data structure. You could go letter by letter in this case. So we find the letter S, for example, and then we find the letter T. And we keep iterating through our data structure until we disambiguate the way that we found the match. By doing this, we're able to search all of our searches at the same time, a single pass through the document. And we're able to emit the matches that we make along the way. And by having a single pass through the document, we now can look at all the different matches we've made, and it's no longer independent. All right, one of the advantages of doing this, now that we've stored everything with similar prefixes in the same kind of bucket, all of those strings are now very compact. So this is very memory efficient, and you can broadcast very large amounts of searches without any worries about memory. And this independence gives us the ability, if we find an actor, right? If we find the word you, we're not going to assign a high likelihood that we found the series you, but if we also find a reference to Penn Badgley in that same document, then we're going to assume that we probably are referring to that series. Likewise, Bright and Will Smith, for example, or orcs, if we want to include topics or elves. I don't remember what else was in that, but something like that. So now we have the ability to create associations within our docs to the entities that are represented in our business data. So what we'll talk about next is how to use all of this to generate insights. One of the things that we have to deal with when we're looking for insights is thinking about internal business jargon. How do we know the difference between something that's referred to internally? And one of the ways that we could do this, I'm gonna kind of skim through this part because I think we're running a little short on time. But one of the ways that we could do this is by using term frequency and inverse document frequency. So we could use the likelihood that a word shows up in Wikipedia, for example, as an estimate of how common that word is. And if that word shows up a lot in our document corpus, but does not show up a lot in Wikipedia, then we can say, this might be it's a good candidate to consider as business jargon. Another way is we can consider LDA, which we talked about earlier, the topic modeling. So look for these terms that show up here that don't seem to be showing up anywhere else. But these are not very flexible ways. Like, we could create these dictionaries of synonyms, but it's much better to think about embeddings. So what is an embedding? An embedding is just a way of taking some kind of concept and projecting it as a number. And you could do that by saying, you know, we have a list of numbers, and this is more of an encoding, right? Where you consider color, number one is red and number two is green. But a better encoding is something that actually makes sense. If you go halfway between two colors, for example, and you're looking at RGB, you get a color that actually does make sense as being between those two colors. You can do math with your embeddings, in other words. So some word embedding models. These are models that take a document and they look at words that are close to each other. This is not the same as understanding language, but words that appear close to each other are likely to be related. And the embeddings that are discovered here do give you surprising relationships. Just training on our internal document set, I was able to replicate a research result that's often given for Word to Vec, where you can add together a king plus a woman minus a man, and the word that comes back is the word queen as the top result. And there were a lot of other kind of fascinating results, and there was a lot of garbage as well. But if you look for one of the acronyms of our internal systems, then the expansion of that acronym actually was one of the recommended results. So this is really good for things like finding synonyms. And you can use this for clustering your documents if they contain common words. But a better way of considering language is something like a transformer model. So transformer models, you know, no discussion of anything having to do with text is complete without talking about it. attention is all you need and all that kind of, you know, all of these large language models and stuff like that. These are far more sophisticated than word embedding models because they actually include information about the order that the words came in. So if you, for example, are searching for one of the kind of canonical results here, if you're searching for what is the capital of the United States, if you put all of your documents into Elasticsearch, as we did, and perform this search on Wikipedia data, the very first thing that comes back is capital punishment in the U.S. because it contains U.S. and it contains the word capital, right? But it's not considering anything to do with the order of the words. But if you use a transformer embedding model, it actually understands that capital of U.S. means something, and it represents that meaning in a meaningful way, all right? So there are a lot of things that you can do with these. One of them that we've implemented is semantic search, where you're taking these word embedding models and you're creating embeddings for every one of the documents and putting them into a vector database. And the idea is when somebody writes a query, you use the same embedding model to embed that query to a vector. And a vector database is just a nearest neighbor type of thing. That's the primary feature of a vector database. What's the nearest neighbor to this query? And it'll be a group of documents. Retrieve and re-rank is kind of a hybrid approach. So you would be able to say, I want to retrieve using a lexical search. This is like, I want to be able to look for all the docs by people in this org, by some sort of filter. And then based on that, I want to re-rank things using the embeddings. So it's kind of like a hybrid get both, best of both worlds. Doc to query is an approach where you go through all of your documents and you have a transformer model spit out what are all of the different questions that this document answers? And you keep that list of questions, and over time you can get user feedback on them, but you just attach those to the document when you store it, and then when people execute searches, they're executing searches against those queries. Summarization, question answer models, I've had mixed results with some of these. With summarization, for example, I used a library. I'll get to that in a minute. But both of these techniques can use the above. Transformer models can summarize your text into something that's much easier to understand, and you can design user experiences around that, as long as you account for the fact that they may not be entirely correct. And question and answer models, similarly, you can use these together with semantic search. You ask a question, like what is the capital of the United States, and it will retrieve all of the documents, such as Wikipedia articles, that it thinks are likely to answer that. And then you use an expensive model to actually find what that answer is and synthesize it. Now we can just call it a day, right? We feed it all to an LLM model. But when I tried to do summarization using one of these state-of-the-art language models, what I found when I looked at our experimentation platform, which is called XP, is that it's about Windows XP. And that's what the summarization was all about, right? So this was the Google's Pegasus X model, which is a very large model and very expensive to calculate with. There are questions, right? Should I use a better model? Will ChatGPT understand my documents? Aside from the fact that it is a third-party API, and I don't want to send our deepest business secrets to a third-party API, there are questions of whether it would understand this business domain. And domain adaptation with large language models, there's this process called fine-tuning, but that's very expensive. You're essentially taking this giant model and you're trying to rerun it. XP, the creator of XP, the namer of XP is taking culpability for this in real time. So I appreciate that. Yes, it's all your fault. but anyway, fine tuning a model is where you take all these giant sets of parameters and you adjust them by running them against internal documents. And you don't necessarily need training data. You could do this unsupervised. You could say, based on our document, you could use something called masking, where you essentially just subtract a word out of every sentence and have the model train by guessing what that word is, right? So you don't need actual question answer training data in order to do domain adaptation. But it's very expensive when you have these giant models. So there are better lower cost techniques. One of them, PEFT, or that's what the whole family is called, but it's parameter efficient fine tuning, where you're only creating an extra little layer that is specific to your domain. And LoRa is the kind of the latest technique, I would say, of that you could use with this, which is a low rank adaptation. But there are a number of other PFT techniques. Another area that you can use to try to improve your results is chunking documents. And this is a much more kind of, not low fidelity, but much more basic way of approaching this. But I think it might actually give us the best results. And that's taking your documents and trying to just improve your parsing of them and to try to shrink them down into units that make more sense. All right, so in summary, if you collaborate with stakeholders to model the business domain, you will probably get better results than if you try to have that model emerge from your documents. Find different tools that you can use, such as like the tri data structure, that which you can use for things like TF-IDF, and use those to understand your resources at scale. And then finally, using contextual data to understand and improve the insights that you get from your documents.